מסכת אוריות, page 9, we'll start the Mishnah, הקדושה, page 8b, the first Mishnah of the Daf. We learned in the previous Mishnah that a par elem davar and par kohen mashiach is brought only for a mistaken ruling about a prohibition that is subject to chatat, to sin offering. Now this Mishnah discusses whether those offerings are brought for a ruling about a law that is subject to a special type. It's called Korban Olevi Yored, special type of chatat, that Korban Olevi Yored, if you remember in the past we discussed, it depends upon the financial situation of a person. So for example, if someone is a well-to-do, the temple treasury impose upon him a expensive offering, versus someone is indigent, is poor, we have a very basic, cheap offering. So that's ole ve'yored, upon the situation, we make a special evaluation. So here is the Mishnah Kedoshah. Ein chayavin, the court, an anointed kohen, are not obligated to bring a par elem davar or par kohen mashiach if they issue a mistaken ruling al aseh ve'al lo ta'aseh shebamikdash, mistaken ruling about a positive commandment or a prohibited prohibition of the temple, which is a positive commandment is an obligation to do something, and the prohibition is an obligation not to do something. So they the prohibition against entering the temple while a person is tameh, meaning he's ritually impure, and the positive commandment is if a person becomes ritually impure, tameh, while is in a temple. So he must leave as quickly as possible in the shortest route. So a person who transgresses, who violated all these laws, does not bring a standard sin, chatat offering, but rather olev yored, verbal chatat offering, and a par elem davar and a par kohen mashiach are bought only for a mistaken ruling about the law that is subject to a standard chatat. So here you have a situation that the person is doubt sometimes whether he's obligated to bring a standard chatat offering. He bring an offering known as Asham Talui. We explain it in the first perek, the second Mishnah. Now, because when it's come to this type of a Asham Talui, the Mishnah discusses whether a person brings an Asham Talui. Asham Talui meaning it's doubt, it's debatable, but it's guilt offering, if he is doubt whether he is obligated to bring a korban olev yored, a verbal chatat offering. Ve'ein mevi'im Asham Talui, similarly, a person does not bring Asham Talui offering if he is unsure whether he violated the positive commandment or prohibition of the temple. And Asham Talui is brought only if a person is unsure whether he is liable to a standard chatat or not. If he is unsure whether he is liable or not, so is liable to bring olev yored, a verbal chatat. So since this type of laws of the Beit HaMikdash, of the Holy Temple in Jerusalem, are subject to a verbal chatat offering, so no Asham Talui is brought this law is relevant only for ordinary individual. When you're dealing with anointed Kohen or court, never brings an Asham Talui for any of the sins. Soon in Mitzvah Shem, we're going to learn the Mishnah. So now we have several, the Mishnah gives us several examples of this type of sins that are subject to a par elem davar or par כהן משיח, אין שם תלוי. אבל חייבים, however the court and the anointed Kohen are liable, על עשה ועל לא תעשה שבה נידה. They are liable to bring the par elem davar and par Kohen Mashiach if they issue a mistaken ruling about the positive commandment or prohibition about, for example, cohabiting with Nida. Nida, as you know, there's women in the time that prohibited to have relation because there are sins that obligated a person to bring a standard chatat, standard sin offering. Umevi'im asham talui, likewise, an individual brings an asham talui if he is unsure whether he violated al aseh ve'al lo ta'aseh sheba nida, the positive commandment or prohibition about a nida. So since these sins are subject to a standard chatat, a standard sin offering, they are subject to the law of asham talui. So the Gemara asks, menahanei milei, from where do you know, from where you derive this point, the tzibur lo mechayvei korban be'alma, that the tzibur, the public, is not liable to bring any offering at all for a sin like defiling of the Beit HaMikdash, which carries no liability for individual to bring a fixed sin offering for violating it unintentionally. V'yachid asham talui namei lo, and also individual that needs to bring asham talui, which is provincial guilt offering for a defiling of the temple of Beit HaMikdash. Amar Rav Yitzchak bar Avdimi ne'amar, now bring the source. The source is from the book of Leviticus chapter 4 and chapter 5. They have a specific word that involved with guilt. They said, ne'emar ve'asham bechatat, when it's come to permanent sin offering for individual, the Torah used the word, and he is guilty, uve'asham talui. So, asham talui, if nefesh achat techta bishgaga ma'amaretz, bazutah achat mitzvot Hashem v'shelo tasena ve'asanu, that kvua, v'im nefesh ki techta v'asar ha'mitzvot Hashem v'shelo tasena ve'lo yada ve'ashem, which means that his provincial guild offering is not true. V'nemar ve'ashem hu betzibur. Parallel davar shel tzibur, the Torah said, v'im kol dat Yisrael ishgur, v'nelam davar me'ene ha'kahal, so it means the ve'ashem hu, they're guilty. So here we learn from this juxtaposition, from verbal analogy, ma ve'ashem biyachid bechatat kvua, af ve'ashemu betzibur bechatat kvua. The same way as we learn, as they is guilty, they are guilty, and he is guilty. You learn that the same rule applies to both. So something it's not chatat kvua etzel ha'yachid, that is a permanent sin offering for individual. The tzibur, the public, not bring any offering. Umat tzibur bechatat kvua, just regard to the sin performed by the general public, the liability to bring a fixed sin offering. Av asham talui name, en ba ela al safek chatat kvua. It's come only for something that's provincial, guilt offering only for uncertainty with regard to a transgression that obligated the person to bring a permanent sin offering. Amre yache korban olev yored name haktiv. When you talk about verbal offering, as we said, for the rich to bring expensive, to poor to bring a cheapest one. So the Torah said in the book of Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 5, verse 5, v'haya ki ye'esham le'achat me'ele, and it shall be when he shall be guilty of one of these matter. So we derive from that it's three different sins. Tum'at mikdash v'kodashav, over al shvuat ha'edut, and shvuat bitui. So Rashi explained that anyone who did one of this, he needs to bring verbal offering, korban ole v'yored. So the Gemara said, respond, danim Hashem min Hashemu, and danim Hashem mi ye'esham. So basically we derive the meaning of they are guilty from the meaning he is guilty. But we don't derive the meaning of he is guilty from the meaning he shall be guilty, even though both are stated in a singular way. So the Gemara said, "Umay nafka mina." What's the real difference between different verb conjunction? V'atana dever Rabbi Ishmael v'shava kohen v'uva kohen. Learned it many times from Vayikra chapter 14, verse 39, that we derive when they said that the kohen shall return, the kohen shall come. Zoi shiva, zoi bia. This return and this coming have the same meaning. So the odd, and furthermore, we learned of this gzerah shava, this verbal juxtaposition, the laf min ve Hashem mitumat migdash b'kodashav, nechtiv dvehu tameh ve Hashem, who derived from the defiling of the temple in his sacrificial food, from the pasuk, and he is ritually impure and he is guilty, which is a verbal analogy between identical terms. Amar Rav Papa, danin ve Hashem u'mitzvot Hashem, min ve Hashem u'mitzvot Hashem. So the Gemara challenge, Amar le Rav Shimi bar Rav Shi le Rav Papa v'neilaf v'Hashem un siat avon min v'Hashem un siat avon. So we should derive this from the Psukim in Leviticus 5, and he is guilty and bearing iniquity, and he is guilty and bearing iniquity, which is the same. So the Gemara again rectified the answer, and they said, "Elam Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak danin v'Hashem u'mitzvot asher lo ta'asena, min v'Hashem u'mitzvot asher lo ta'asena, ve'al yochiach shmi'at kol u'vitui shvatayim v'dumat mikdash kodashav shelo ne'emar b'hem v'Hashem." And therefore, you should not go by statement of a lip, which is an oath of an utterance, and defiling of the Beit HaMikdash and its sacrificial food, which is liable to bring a sliding scale offering, shall not prove otherwise, as it is not stated concerning them, and he is not guilty. Shalom emar b'hem v'Hashem u'mitzvot asher lo ta'asena, the commandment of God that shall not be done. So what you see here, that Rav Nachman bar Yitzchak called that this type of verbal analogy, the juxtaposition, it accepted between psukim, that they have three utterances and three expressions that basically meshutafim, they have the same concept, the same meaning. So therefore, we derive asham talui from parelem davar, that they have three the same expressions. Ve Hashem, mitzvot Hashem, asher lo te'asena. And Tosfot HaRosh explain, you cannot derive asham talui from verbal offering from korban o levi ored, because they have only two between meshutafim, two same utterances. So here we go to the next Mishnah. And the next Mishnah continue with the law that we learned earlier. Now the Mishnah defines the positive commandment and a prohibition of a nida. They said, "Ein chayavim al shmi'at kol ve'al bitui sfatayim." So, having said that Paralem Davar and Paral Kohen Mashiach, we said it the previous Mishnah, I'm not so sure. Ezo mitzvah shel benita, prosh min adam mitzvah lasal tavon nida. Alright. Having said that a Paralem Davar and Paral Kohen Mashiach are not brought for mistaken rulings about the sins that are subject to a verbal chatat offering, the Mishnah gives more examples of such sins. And Chayavin al shmi'at kol v'al bitui sfatayim, the rabbinic court and the anointed kohen are not obligated to bring a par elem davar or par kohen mashiach for a mistaken ruling about the sin of hearing the sound of oath, that is falsely swearing that one does not testimony about a particular event, and v'al bitui sfatayim, or about declaring a false oath with the lips, that is not keeping one's oath or swearing falsely about the past event, which, for example, he swore that he will not eat and he ate, or he swore that he had eaten previously but he actually did not do so. Val tumat mikdash vekodashav, and about the ritual impurity of the temple and its holy things, that is entering the temple or eating offering while a person tameh, that's what we mentioned the law in the previous Mishnah. These three sins are subject to a verbal chatat offering. That was the Torah said in Leviticus chapter 5. So therefore, if the court or anointed Kohen made a mistaken ruling about any of this matter, no par elem davar or par Kohen Mashiach is brought. So the Mishnah turns to a related subject. The Torah states that if the king unintentionally commits a sin that is subject to a chatat, to a sin offering, he does not bring a standard chatat, but rather a special offering known as a asher nasi chatat. So a nasi chatat, it is known this way because when discussing this offering, the Torah referred to a king as a nasi in Leviticus 4, verse 22. So they said, with regard to these sins, the king is like them, the court and noiti kohen, that is, he does not bring an offering, he does not bring an asichatat, because, like the parelem davar and par kohen mashiach, the asichatat is brought only for those sins that are subject to a standard chatat, and these are subject to a verbal chatat, and he does not bring a verbal chatat, because only for a commoner and not a king can bring a verbal chatat. the Torah says, states that the verbal chatat is brought in a different form depending on the wealth of a person bringing it, as we explained earlier. So it is clear that this offering is brought by a person who might be either poor or rich. A king who is always wealthy is not subject to that offering. So you see later on in the Gemara, so that's Divrei Rabbi Yossi Aglili. The next Tana disagree. Rabbi Akiva says, Hanasi chayav bechulan chutz mishviat hakol. The king is obligated to bring verbal chatat for all these things, except for the sin of hearing the sound of an oath. So according to Rabbi Akiva, a king can bring a verbal chatat. Rabbi Akiva learns it from the Pasuk in the Torah. And the Meiri explained that since the king is always wealthy, he brings a verbal chatat brought by a wealthy person, a female sheep or goat. So they said, and he does so for the sin of declaring a false oath, or an tum'ah of the temple and its holy thing, tum'at mikdash v'kodashav. However, he does not bring any offering for falsely swearing that he does not know testimony. Shamelech lo dan velo daninoto, because the king may not judge a case and other may not judge him. So the sages decree that the king should not be judged out of concern that due to his high position, he will not obey the court's ruling, and he is therefore cannot serve as a judge because we have a rule that the person who may not be judged may not judge others. Lo me'id velo me'idin oto. He may not testify, that's in parentheses, because not everyone goes like that. But anyway, he is not testified against other, and other not testified against him, since he cannot testify anyway. He does not bring an offering for withholding testimony, even if he made a false oath about it. That's, if you remember, we studied in Tractate Shvuot, page 31. Amar Ula. So now the Gemara dealt with the view of Rabbi Yossi Aglili in regard to the king that is exempting from Korban Olev Yored, from the verbal offering. So Ula said, Amar Ula, Maitamad Rabbi Yossi Aglili. What the reasoning of Rabbi Yossi Aglili that hold that way, that Amar Kra, the Pasuk, in Korban Olev Yored, in verbal offering, V'haya ki yesham le'echad me'ele, and it shall be when he shall be guilty of one of these matters, in Leviticus 5, verse 5, kol shemitchayev be'achad mitchayev be'kulan, ve'en mitchayev be'achad mitchayev be'kulan. Anyone who is liable of one of every one of the instances which bring a sliding scale offering becomes liable to all of the instances, otherwise not. So the Gemara asks, you may say that he is liable to bring any of all of these instances, bring a sliding scale offering, and this is halakha, even though it does not become liable to in all of them. The source is from the following pasuk, the Tanya, Haya Rabbi Yirmiyah Omer. This is what Rabbi Yirmiyah said. Ne'emar, the Torah said in Vayikra, in Leviticus chapter 5, verse 7, in regards to the Korban Olev Yored, the verbal offering, as we said many times, is the offering that applies. If he's rich, he gets expensive, a liability of bringing an expensive offering, versus if he's poor, is the minimum offering, evaluated by the temple treasury. Page 9, Lo tagi yado, ve'ne'emar lo tasig yado. So in Leviticus 5, verse 7, they said, if his means suffice not. And then they said in the same perek, the same chapter 5, but verse 11, they said, and if his means not suffice. So you see here, almost the same notion, which is the sliding scale offering applies only Mi shebali dei aniyut ve'ashirut, one unfortunately who come to a situation that he is oppressed for fund, is poverty stricken, or the other way around, and wealth. But yatzan asiyu mashiach shen ba'in lidei aniyut. But when you come to a king, an anointed kohen, cannot be in a state of poverty, ever. Nasi dichti v'asa achad mikol mitzvot Hashem Elohav, mi shen al gabav el Hashem Elohav. Mashiach dechtiva kohen gadol me'echav, shu gadol me'echav benoi, bekoach, bechokhmah u'ba'osher. So you see here sources that both the king and the anointed kohen, they advance to others. One of them is the wealth. Acherim omrim, that's always Rabbi Meir, that's what we learn on page, we're going to learn again on page 13. So they said, he said, menayin sheim en lo gadleu mishel echav. How do you know that if the kohen gadol not have this financial situation, you should make him great from his from the property of his brother. Talmud lomar v'akohen hagadol me'echav asher yutzak al rosho gadlehu me'echav, because the Leviticus 10 said, and the kohen that is the greater among these brethren. So you derive from this that this is our obligation to make him great in the property of his brethren. So he'll provide him the enough property to make him wealthy. So that's, again, it's not applied to Korban Olev Yored, verbal offering, that someone is financial situation, either make him poor or rich. So therefore, it's not applied to that. There's a big discussion, Yishar Horai and others discuss, what exactly obligation, if that applied to any Kohen Gadol, even if it wasn't anointed or not. Big discussion. Let's continue. Ba'amine Ravina Merav Nachman Bar Yitzchak, Nasi Shenitztarea Mahu. God forbid you have a king that was afflicted with leprosy and unfit to serve a king during his affliction. So when it's come to a sliding scale offering, Midchad Dachei or Miptar Patir, you exempt him or you say that you eliminated him. Amar Le Dilach O De Gaza, which is, he said, does he bring an offering from your property, which is from public property, or he bring an offering from a personal treasurer? Why? Because we obviously will not bring an offering from his own personal treasury. He remained exempt from bringing the offering. Tan Rabbi Akiva omer Mashiach patur mikulam. Amar Rava Amar Rabbi Akiva Amar Kra Ze Korban Aharon Uvanav Zo Ba Chova Lo Ven Acheret Parva Lo. That's come to obligate him, derived from Aaron, and no other such offering come to obligate from him. That's so little, asirita efa is one tenth of efa of meal offering mentioned in the pasuk. But the God did not exclude in the Torah from the dove brought as a slice scale offering due to poverty, and the vice versa, and the sheep is slice offering of one who's wealthy. לא סגל אתר דכתיב וחיפר עליו הכהן לחטאתו אשר חטא באחת מאלה מתכפר באחד מתכפר בכולם ושנתכפר באחד מתכפר בכולם. The one who's atoned for one, one who's gained atonement with every one of the type of sliding scale offering, gained atonement with any of the type of sliding scale offering, and one is not, so he's not naming for any type of slide offering. למה אתר דכתיב היה כי השם לאחת מאלה, פסוק said in Leviticus 5, And it shall be when he shall be guilty of one of these matters. So we shall give an interpretation. Same notion. Said the king is liable for all of these cases, except for a case of hearing of a voice, which means that he cannot become liable in the rest of the instances, even if he exempt in one. Remember, the kol mitchavei b'asirit eifa mitchavei b'kulam. That one who needs to bring a tenth of eifa can become liable to bring any of them. This agaratach mitchavei b'achad, that if you tell me that he's obligated with one of them, afal pi she'ein mitchavei b'kulam, nichteva lehay me'achat me'ele bet dalut. So therefore the Torah phrased for one of these with regard to offering broad due to unfortunate situation of poverty, or alternatively, inam eiba ashirut, the broad who does wealthy. So because it does not appear with regard to one of these offering, so you see that if you have a situation, God forbid, of extreme poverty, that one who cannot become liable for that offering is exempt for the entire matter. Mishnah put together, that's the last Mishnah of this Perek, and he is basically put together all the rules with a chiyuv of Yachid. Kol ha-mitzvot sheba-Torah shechayavin al zdonam karet val shigetam chakat. So here you have a summarized the Mishnah when the different type of chatat offering, those of an ordinary individual, a king, anointed kohen, and the court are brought. So any of the commandments in the Torah for which a person is liable to a karet, if he transgressed it intentionally, val shigigatan chatat, in obligate to bring chatat and transgress unintentionally, hayachid mevi kisba v'sira, one individual needs to bring a female sheep or goat, v'anasi sa'ir, and the king needs to bring a male goat, u'mashiach u'bedin mevim par, an anointed kohen in the court should bring a bull as par elem davar or par kohen mashiach. Ubavodat kochavim, an unintentional scene involved with idol worship, hayachid v'anasi v'amashiach mevim se'ira, so individual, the king and anointed kohen need to bring female goat for a chatat, ubedin par v'sa'ir, and if the call rule to permit idol worship and the people follow the ruling, they'll bring bull and a male goat as offering, par le'ola v'sa'ir lechatat, the bull for a burn offering and a male goat for sin offering. So the Mishnah said, ordinary individual, asham talui, if they commit an act that is subject to an asham talui, hayachid, an individual, v'hanasi, and the king, chayavim, obligated to bring asham talui, u'mashiach bedin pturim, anointed kohen, and court are in doubt whether they are seen, that is, they rule that a certain act is permitted, they are exempt for bring an asham talui. Asham vadai, if they commit an act that is subject to a standard asham offering, hayachid v'anasi v'amashiach chayavim, an individual king anointed kohen are obligated to bring in a standard asham. Ubedin pturim, however, the rabbinic court permitted one of the sins that are subject to a standard asham, they are exempt from offering. Al shmiat kol, regarding two sins of hearing the sound of an oath, val bitui sfataim, declaring a false oath with the lips, val tumat mikdash v'kodashav, and Tumah of the temple and his holy things, all of which are subject to a verbal chatat offering. The law is as following, bedin pturim, if the court ruled to permit one of these sins and the people follow the ruling, the court is exempt from a verbal chatat offering. Havayachid v'anasiv ha-mashiach hayavim, however, individual king and anointed kohen are obligated to bring an offering if they commit any of these sins. Another option, אלא שאין כהן גדול חייב על תומת מקדש וקודשיו, דברי רבי שמעון. Both a king and an anointed kohen are liable to an offering in most of these cases, except that the anointed kohen gadol is not obligated to bring an offering for tum'ah of Beit HaMikdash, temple and its holy things. That's the view of Rabbi Shimon. Umay Meviim, what type of offering they need to, the anointed Kohen, the king needs to bring. Korban Olev Yored, according to that view, is the verbal Chatat offerings, such as an ordinary individual bring for these transgressions. The next Tana discusses in one case, Rabbi Eliezer Omer, Rabbi Eliezer Hold says, for Tum'ah of Mikdash veKodasha, for the temple and its holy things, Hanasi mevi Seir, the king brings a male goat, Nasi Chatat, and not verbal offering. So again, the Mishnah here speak about what we learned in the previous Mishnah, that the Nasi Chatat is brought only for sins that are subject to karet and done intentionally, and standard Chatat when done unintentionally. So here Rabbi Eliezer disagree, and he hold that Nasi Chatat is brought for any sin that is subject to karet, even if it's not subject to a standard Chatat, such as Tumah of the Beit Mikdash B'Kodashav, the temple, which is subject to karet when done intentionally, but to a verbal Chatat when it's done unintentionally. So anyway, here is the Gemara, Tana Rabbi Shimon, Hayan Oten Klal. So he brings Rabbi Shimon here, bring a principle. Kol Shayechid Basham Talui Anasika Yotzebo. Any case that you have a individual is liable to bring a provincial guilt offering, so the status of the king is like that individual. Mashiach Ubedin Pturim. And the anointed Kohen and the court are exempt. V'chol shu ba'asham badai, any case that is individual who's liable to bring a definite guilt offering, nasiu mashiach ha'kayotze b'hem ubedin pturim. The king and anointed Kohen is like the individual, and the court is exempt. Shmi'at ha'kol, b'tu yisvatayim, the same rules we explained in the Mishnah, just repeat it in that sense. Shmi'at ha'kol b'tu yisvatayim b'tumat mikdash v'kodashah b'din pturim nasi mashiach ha'yavim, el ha'shen nasi chaya b'shmi'at ha'kol, v'lo mashiach b'tumat mikdash v'kodashah, kol shu b'lev v'ored, nasi v'kayotze b'hem mashiach b'din pturim. So the Gemara said, if that's the case, aguf akashia, the bright itself is difficult. Amar da shen Mashiach chayav b'tumat mikdash v'kodashav b'tumat mikdash v'kodashav u'de patur, avlo shmiyat hakol u'bitul sfatayim chayav. So it's kind of contradicted. So ema sefer, let's go a little less close of the bright. Kol shu b'lev v'yored, anyone is in a verbal offering. Nasika yotzer bo Mashiach u'bedin pturim. Katani Mashiach u'bedin pturim, ma'bedin pturim mikulon. The same way as the rabbinic court is exempt from all of them. Af Mashiach patur mikulon, af anointed Kohen is exempt from all of them, not only from the offering for defiling of the Beit HaMikdash and its sacrificial foods. Page 9b, Kashya Na'adadei, the Braitot contradict each other. There is a book called Chok Natan, and also Magen Givurim, Tosfot Rosh, that challenge this question. But anyway, Amar Avuna Breder Rav Yoshua Lo Kashya, Kan Bedalut, Kan Bedalei Dalut. The first one dealing with a situation of poverty, the other one, it's really like extreme poverty. So if that's a situation, then he doesn't need to bring any other mincha, excluding chavitei kohen gadol. That's what Rashi said. Rabbi Shimon savar ki Rabbi Akiva b'chada, u'palik alei b'chada. Rabbi Shimon agree with Rabbi Akiva in one sense, and the other one he disagree with him. Savir la Rabbi Akiva b'dalei dalut patur. He agreed that it was extreme poverty, so they'll leave it alone. He's exempt from bringing offering, and that's what derived from Zekor ban Aaron u'banav. So he doesn't bring mincha for his extreme poverty, that for one of the three sins that you need to bring a verbal offering. Upaligalei disagree with him b'dalut. In the situation, this is a regular verbal offering, which is either poverty or wealth, that and he does not hold that the anointed Kohen is completely exempt for bringing a sliding scale offering. The Mishnah said, "Ela she'en Kohen Gadol Chayav al Tumat Mikdash v'Kodashav." Divrei Rabbi Shimon, Amar Rav Chizkiya Ma'atamad Rabbi Shimon Dichtiv v'Nichreta Nefesh Ha'im Mitoch HaKahal. The pasuk said that soul shall be cut off from the midst of the congregation. That's in the Book of Numbers, chapter 19, verse 20. So the wife of that, Mishikobano Shavela Kahal, Yatzazeshen Kovado Shavela Kahal. You go for someone whose whose offering is equal to offering of the congregation, which is the Jewish people, but Kohen Gadol, that it's not. It's in Yom Kippur, the bring of a bull for his unintentional transgression, while he bring a goat to achieve atonement for the Jewish people. Im ken asin amen korbanu shaveh lekal, if that's the case, king also is not the same. Shaveh bekaparad Yom Kippurim, but is when it's come to atonement Yom Kippurim, the king is equal to the people. Im ken kohanim name lo shavu lekal bekaparad Yom Kippurim, the priests are not the same as the kahal, the congregation, when it's come to Yom Kippurim, as the anointed, the way that they atonement is achieved by means of bull of the Kohen Gadol. So the Kohanim shavu lakal b'shar mitzvot d'shana kula, they equal the Kohanim to the other people, the congregation, with regard to atonement for the rest of the mitzvot of the entire year. Mashiach name ha'shaveh b'shar mitzvot d'shana. So they said, el ha'marav ha'imachem mishachadato shava l'yechidim u'mayni u'kahal. Whoever is the sin offering equal to the individual, and who are these individuals? That's the congregation. The status of congregation that perform unintentional transgression is not in the basis of the ruling of the court, is that of individuals. The Kohen Gadol sin offering is different. He brings a sin offering only for unintentional transgressions that he perform on the basis of his own ruling. Here Rabbi Eliezer אומר הנשיא מביא שעיר, אמר רבי יוחנן לו, אמר רבי אליעזר לבטומת מקדש וקדושיו, הול ונאמר בו כרת, בו, נאמר כרת בו כבקבועה. So it's because they said that the whole concept of כרת, liability to bring a fixed offering. So the same way as the king brings a goat as a sin offering for any unintentional transgression, the same way is here, he bring a goat for a defiling of the Beit HaMikdash. So others liable to bring a sliced scale offering, and for his individual violation is not liable to receive karet, the king is also liable to bring a sliding scale offering. Amar ha-papa ha-chana mistabra di-saka datach ha-bili-ezer al-kulon ka-amar, mikdei sa'ir nasi u-par mashiach במקום יחיד לחטאת קאי, ניתנה ממשיח ומביא פר בשמיעת קול וביטוי שפתיים, אלא בלא קטן ממשיח, שמאמינה אטומת מקדש וקדושת קיץ, דמשיח פטור. אומר לרב הונא מרי דרב נתן לרב פאפא ממאי, דילמה רב אליעזר הכולו יקרן. ומשיח סבל הקירה והקירה ועד אמר, משיח פטור בכולם, אמר לרבי עקיבא, מביתר לה מפר ותו לא מידי. אומר רבי יוחנן, מודה רב אליעזר שאין מביא אשם. רב אליעזר concede that the king does not bring a guilt offering for the defiling of the temple and its sacrificial food, tumat mikdash vekodashav. Tane tana kamed rav sheshet, asham talui ba al tumat mikdash vekodashav. Amar le damar lachmani, rabbi Eliezer idamar oil venemar bo karet bekvua, amay tenasi sa'ir alea. Since karet is stated in a fixed offering, a king bring a goat for the defiling of the temple, since the status of a sin offering is like of a fixed sin guilt offering, So in case of uncertainty, it is liable to bring a provincial guilt offering. So Rav Sheshet asks, ואמר רבי יוחנן, מודה רבי אליעזר שאין מביא אשם תלוי. But Rabbi Yochanan said that when it's a ספק, it's uncertain, תומת מקדש וקודשיו, the king does not bring a provincial guilt offering. So the Gemara concluded, indeed, based on the statement of Rabbi Yochanan, the kashya, it's really difficult that you cannot bring this brayta according to any one of the Tanaim. And the Magen Giborim and other Mefoshim said that Rav Sheshet rejected this brayta from the view of Rabbi Yochanan, because it was known that his view is well accepted in the Beit HaMidrash, Hadran Halach Ora Kohen Mashiach, we Baruch Hashem, reached the point that we complete this Perek Sheni, הורה כהן משיח עם מסכת הוריות.